a few comments before we I unpack Psalm 42 for all of us. I like Psalm 42 because it gives us a very realistic picture of life. Right? There are times we are a mountain high because we have an answered prayer and God deliver us. There'll be time we're in a pit and we can't really see the end of it. And there'll be Psalms 88 next week. Right? Psalms 88 is the saddest psalm. And we'll unpack that next week. Why am I up there? Huh? Sorry. I need to project. I haven't shared yet. Okay. Sorry. I very scared to see myself like that up there. Am I sharing screen already? Okay. Yeah. So this psalm is a mixture of struggle and hope. Right, and I thought this is and later when we play the song From Sorrow Deep I Call, I thought it's a very good psalms that describe the state of this psalmist. Right, on one hand he struggle, on one hand he still hope in God. Next week you come, then we talk about the saddest psalm, and how we can find redemption even in the saddest psalm. All right, but for tonight we let's focus on Psalms 42, and I want to unpack for us what we can learn from Psalms 42. Now, this is a sermon I preached several years ago, and I preach it in BBTC, and I preach it in Hope Church as well. I entitled it A Song in the Night, because Psalms 42 was meant to be sung at night. Right? So I hope I trust that you see the question and the complaints in Psalms 42. The psalmist was very real with God. Now, the psalmist, in most Bible says that songs of Korah, right? And some people believe that it could be influenced by Song of David as well. That means David wrote it originally, and the songs of Korah edited it for this, for what we are getting it today. That's what a scholar believes. But I think this is just, I'm just giving you some background to the thinking behind these psalms, all right? But nevertheless, we can see that the psalmist was very real with God. He did not hold back his frustration. And that's something I want to encourage all of us, because sometimes we have this wrong idea that because I'm a Christian, I cannot have problem. And so even if you have problem, you try to deny it. Now, I've seen some Christian who try to ignore the fact that they're having problem in life. They are overly positive to the point that their positivity is toxic. There's such a term called toxic positivity, and we must steer clear from it. God wants us to be realistic, not just positive. He did not hold back his frustration nor hide his feelings, because it is okay to be real with God. You know that, right? Like it is okay because God knows exactly what's going on in your life. It is all right to be honest with God, to tell God how you really feel. Even when you are feeling angry, all right? Some people say, good Christian never get angry. Is that true? Okay, that's not what the Bible says, by the way. All right? Jesus never said, don't get angry. In fact, the Word of God says, be angry and do not sin. Right? It's taken from Ephesians 4:26, be angry but do not sin. Why? Because anger is a natural response to emotional pain or to the things that irritates us. But the more important thing is do not sin. In your anger, do not sin. You see, anger has the potential to take us deeper in our intimacy with God when we bring that what hurts us to God for healing. Let me emphasize the last part. When we bring what hurt us to God. The problem with most of us is that we are angry, but we don't bring what hurts us to God. We bring what hurts us to the people who hurt us. So what do you get? Fight, right? So the word of God is teaching us to bring what hurts us to God, so that you can find healing and you can find new level of intimacy with God. Even when you feel you're not good enough, or when you feel like you need help. Feeling of desperation can push us to our knee and closer to God. Now, desperation is only a blessing when we allow God to exchange it with His love and pain and His plan. All right? Desperation in and of itself is not helpful. But we must use the desperation to bring us to God. But watch out for pride. Because some people say that, no, don't worry, I can handle. So what you are saying is that you don't need God. So watch out for that. All right, so I've spoken enough. Let me just talk about Psalms 42. There are four ways that we can be real with God. We can see that, I'm going to start from verse 9 all the way to verse 1. I'm going to start the reverse, okay? So verse 9, you learn that he asked God why. In other words, you can ask God why. I want to emphasize that because I grew up being taught that I cannot ask why. But today, I want to free you from those wrong teaching. We can ask God why. God is more secure than most of us dare to believe. Right? He can handle our whys. So it's okay to ask God why. And then he affirmed God's sovereign love. He preached to his own soul and he thirsts for God. Okay, so let me show you, first of all, verse 9, I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? So what he meant was, it looks like, and it felt like God has forgotten him. Why does he feel that way? Because he feels like, God, you are so silent. Are you real? Have you heard of this train of thought before? I was looking for God, but God did not appear. Therefore, God is not real. What's wrong with this kind of thinking? If I cannot see God, therefore God is not real. Right? This is known as a category fallacy. Let me explain to you. There are things that exist that cannot be seen. For example, your value system, your thoughts, your ideas. For that matter, music. Can you see music? You cannot see music, you hear music. Right? Okay, so when you talk about category fallacy, basically means that assigning a property which applies to an object of another category. Meaning this, what is the color of a musical note? Can you see the color of the musical note? You can't, right? Because musical note is a category of sound. Color is a category of vision. And so when you assign a property to a wrong category, God, is God visible? God is spirit. And spirit is not visible. That's why the Bible says God is unseen. Right? And the Bible also warns us, no one can see God and live. Right? Talking about the holiness of God. Some objects are partly visible. We do not see the 3D object in their entirety. Like for example, our body, we cannot see fully. Right? Yet we believe in what we do not really see. How many of you know that? Where is your heart? Where is your heart? Here, right? Can you see your heart? Not yet. But yet you know that it's there, right? Why? Because of some scientific pictures and all that, right? So we can't really see, but by faith we believe it's here. But some of us, our heart is actually on this side. There are some people, their heart is actually on the other side. Right? There are other ways of seeing, other form of awareness, other than sensory perception. That means other than visual. Right? You can sense something without seeing them. Right? You can sense something without seeing. For example, fear. Can you see fear? You cannot. But you can walk into a place and sense fear. Or Sometimes you can walk in a place and you can sense the holy presence of God. Okay, God. Okay, let me give. Can I digress a bit? Okay, I'm going to digress anyway. I was in Israel and I was in Davidson Tunnel and I was asking the guide, where is the lost ark? Where's the ark of the covenant? And so long story cut short, he was narrating an account to me that this particular rabbi went into this tunnel and was following the tunnel because according to what their old documents and all that, they sense that if this tunnel can maybe to lead to an inner chamber of the Temple Mount. And he was walking his way into the tunnel. And then suddenly, he felt the presence of God. And he dare not move. So he backtracked and he consulted the rest of the rabbi. They decided to call the chief rabbi for wisdom. And the chief rabbi told them, this is not the time to explore further. Sealed up the tunnel. And therefore the tunnel is being sealed up. Right? So the guy believed with all their hearts that this tunnel will lead them to find the Ark of Covenant. Why? Because this particular rabbi felt the presence of God. And so there are times that, or there are places that you walk into, you can feel the presence of God. Or sometimes in the height of worship, we can feel the presence of God. But can you see the presence of God? You don't really see, right? You just sense it. So there's other way of sensory perception. So just because we can't see God doesn't mean that God is not real. God can reveal himself in other forms. Now, especially when we are sad, especially when we are overwhelmed by problems, we can't see or we can't sense so well. Because we are already overwhelmed by all the negative senses. So when you are sad, when you are very disappointed, don't trust your feeling. Right? Allow a good friend to come alongside to guide you. Okay? So it's okay to be raw with our feelings with God, but do not stop there. Because like I say, our when you are in pain and all that, all your senses are filled with negative feelings. Right? So don't stop there. Right, application, allow yourself to be raw, to express your raw emotions with God because he knows our emotions. Right? He won't judge, he understands, so he will not judge you with the way where you ask why. In fact, he will welcome you to ask why so that you can get the negative emotion out of your system. And that's what the psalmist did. Then next, he affirms God's sovereign love. Verse 8. The Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime and his songs will be with me in the night. A prayer to the God of my life. Right? So verse 5 and verse 11, he says that God is my help and my God. Right? So he affirms God's sovereign. So in your pain, remember God's love. Right? Don't be so caught up with pain that you miss out his love. Remember his love. He never stopped believing in the absolute sovereignty of God, even in a time of adversities. You just look at the structure. Problems, promise. Problem, promise. Problem, promise. Problem, promise. Okay, you can see that on one hand, he admits that there's a problem. On the other hand, he reminds himself of the promises of God. So in our struggling, don't forget the promises of God. Right, while he expressed his raw emotions, he reminded himself of the love of God so that he would not make wrong conclusion. So the application for us is to assure ourselves of his love even as you walk through difficult times. Right? Especially in songs. Let me give you three examples. When Darlene was going through a hard time, at 1993, at the age of 28, he was experiencing a very dark period of his life. She was broke and she was in debt and so forth. And she was crying out to the Lord for deliverance. And out of his tears, out of his cry, and he read Psalms 96, and that's where the song Shout to the Lord came out. Right? Same for Amazing Grace, written by this guy called John Newton, a sailor who and a slave trader who became a Christian, a minister and an abortionist. Right? When you look at his life, he was so convicted of what a great sinner he had been. But yet at the same time, he saw the grace of God. And that's why you get a song, Amazing Grace. Similarly, this song, It Is Well With My Soul, written by this guy, Spafford, where he went to this place, the ocean, where they say that this is roughly the place that four of your daughters drowned with a broken heart crying out to God. And the Lord gave him the song, It Is Well With My Soul. They are real with their pain, but at the same time, they are reminded of the love of God. Right? So don't focus on our pain, but allow God's love to pierce through our pain. So application is that keep affirming God's love in your life, even when you're going through pain. Assure yourself of God's love. And then the third thing, he preached to his own soul. All right? Why are you in despair, O my soul? And why have you become disturbed within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him for the help of his presence. So what this verse 5, verse 11 reminded us is that we must learn to speak to our soul rather than allow ourselves to speak to us. Because most of the time we are unhappy because we are listening to ourselves. So I already mentioned that just now. The words from Martin Lloyd-Jones, right? That we must learn to preach to ourselves the word of God. Right? Psalmist says, listen, I will speak to you. Hope in God. We must learn to preach the gospel of hope to ourselves. Proverbs 18:21 tells us, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. So what we say to ourselves is very important. Okay, there's something, don't say in your heart. Really say it literally. Right? What do you say to yourself? What do you say to yourself? These are just examples. All right? I matter. I'm love. Okay, can we say together? All right, at the count of three, let's say it together. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3. I matter. I am love. I can make it. I'm hanging it there. I will not give up. I am blessed. I'm a winner. I'm more than a conqueror. I favor with God and with men. I am strong. I am healed. I am whole. I can do this. Yes, I can. Amen? And we must speak to our soul the promises of God. Right? Not the sin of this world, but the promises of God. These are just some example of how when you hear yourself saying to yourself, I'm nothing special, remind yourself, I'm God's workman. When you feel like I'm not good enough, tell yourself, I'm chosen by God to bear fruit. When you feel that I never accomplished anything worthwhile, remember, speak to yourself, I have divine purpose and calling. When you are feeling defeated, you feel like giving up, remind yourself, you are victorious, you can overcome. When you feel like you're too broken, too distraught, remember, you have a heart and mind that is protected by God's peace. When you feel like you are stuck in this unhealthy place, remember the word of God, you are set free. Amen? I claim the word of God in your situation. So I tell you, you can ask God why, all right? But as you ask God why, remember the love of God. And don't just stop that, you must learn to preach to your soul the promises of God. And then finally, curse on God. Psalmist says in verse 1 and 2, as the deer pants for the water brook, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? Now question, what was he not thirsting for? So clever. He was not asking for actual water. He's not asking for relief from his threatening situation, nor escape from his enemy. What was he asking for? He was asking for God himself. Four times he asked for God. Why? Because when you have God, you have everything you need. All right? So turn every pain, disappointment back. Use every pain in your life as a sword for your thirst for God. Every setback, every pain, every disappointment, everything that irritates you, turn that to become salt so that you become thirsty for more of God. Let me end with a personal story. 2008 was a time of change for me. At that time, I've been working in a certain church for 18 years. 18 years is a long time, all right? And at the end of the 18 years, I felt the Lord call me to leave this comfortable place to something else. Now, if you follow God, right, sometimes God may not give you the full blueprint of everything, but enough to know that you need to move. So 2008, by faith, I shared my intention to move, to leave the church that I was working. It was a year. It ignited a nuclear bomb in my life. Right? You see, I've been in that church for 18 years. I literally grew up as a Christian in that church. And so all my friends, all my mentors, all my leaders were in that church. But because I expressed that sense of calling, all my leaders became my enemies, or I became their enemies. And it was a time of pain and backstabbing. People began to say all the bad things about it. Suddenly when I say I think God is calling me to leave, suddenly I have a lot of problems, you know. Before that, I was given the highest level of bonus that was given out that year. Right? Now, when the bonuses are given, means that you are performing well, right? But the moment I declare my intention to resign, I became the worst employee of the year. It was a difficult time, right? And I was misunderstood. And so there was a lot of pain. There was a lot of disappointment. I still remember I went to my mentor. I was sharing with my mentor, and my mentor asked me a very simple question. Saying, "What do you want?" And I cried out. I says, "I want to go home." It's a pastor's way of saying I'm suicidal, lah. All right. That was where I was. And in my pain, I know enough to not dwell in my pain for too long. So I'll play worship song as a background sound for myself. And in one of these songs, it's a Hokkien song. And I just read it, I translate in English for you, okay? It basically means that Jesus knows my heart, he comforts and he blesses me with life. He blesses me with peace, he blesses me with joy. Even when I walk through stormy path, he knows and he understands. He wiped away my tears and he gave me security. It's a Hokkien song, all right? And I'm not Hokkien, I'm Teochew, by the way. But that day when I was just crying before the Lord, and this song was at the background, suddenly this word, he understands. He knows and he understands. It's just something special for that moment. It connects in my soul. The comfort that God understands. God knows what I was going through. And that began the journey of healing for myself. And today, the fact that I can talk about this is because I'm healed. I'm able to go back to the group of friends, and I still call them friends. Because I know that they had their own issues, because they see people's resignation as betrayer. Right? And I understand where they come from. And the Lord healed me. All right? When you turn to him, when we don't run away from God, but we use our pain as salt to bring us closer to God. So the psalmist, so we can learn from the psalmist, it's okay to ask, allow ourselves to ask why, assure ourselves of God's love, address the self-talk that we have, and help ourselves to worship God. And God will help us because He is our peace. He is our hope. So with that, I've come to the end of Psalms 42. And just in case you think Psalms 42 is difficult, wait till you come back next week where we learn about the saddest psalm, all right? And what is so redemptive. I hope to show you the redemptive part of it, even in the saddest psalm. But tonight, we're going to end off by playing this song, The Deep Sorrow, From Deep Sorrow I Come. I want to encourage us to just allow the songs to... It is a modern rendition of Psalms 42. All right? And allow the Lord to minister to us. Because I sense that even in a crowd like this, some of us, life is not all glorious for you. You're persevering. And I just want to encourage you to know that God understands. God knows. Just as He encouraged me in my pain, God wants to encourage you in your pain. So as Mithy played this YouTube song for us, let it minister to our heart and draw us back to worship. Draw us back to God. So over to you, Mithy.
Lord, from sorrows deep I call, when my hope is shaken, torn and ruined from the fall, hear my desperation. For so long I've pled and prayed, God, come to my rescue. Even so the thorn remains, still my heart will praise You. Storms within my troubled soul, questions without answers, on my faith these pillows roll. God, be now my shelter. Why are You cast down, my soul? Fires have all grown cold, cause this heart to praise You. Should my life be torn from me, every worldly pleasure, when all I possess is grief, God be then my treasure. Be my vision in the night, be my hope and refuge, till my face is turned aside, Lord, my heart will praise You. Oh, my soul, put Your hope in God, my help, my rock, I will praise Him. Sing, oh, sing, through the raging storm, You're still my God, my salvation. Salvation.
I'm going to ask Nitya to play this song again. Can I invite all of us on site to just stand up and just let this song minister to you and just cry out to the Lord, right? And even for those of you who are at home, I want to encourage you to just surrender your pain to God, to dare trust God, that the Lord, the goodness of God, will fill your heart. Yes, that indeed that your vision will become, that your faith can turn to sight. That your faith can turn to sight. As you dare to trust God, the day will come that your faith will become something that you can see. But meanwhile, we must be like this, the psalmist, that we tell our soul, put our hope in God. Tell your soul, I will put my hope in God. So as we play this song again, make this our prayer to God. Tell the Lord, from sorrow deep I call.
Lord, from sorrows deep I call, when my hope is shaken, torn and ruined from the fall. Hear my desperation, for so long I've pled and prayed. God, come to my rescue. Even so, the thorn remains, still my heart will praise you. Storms within my troubled soul, questions without answers, on my faith these billows roll. God, be now my shelter. Why are you cast down my soul? Hope in him who saves you. When the fires have all grown cold, cause this heart to praise you. Should my life be torn from me, every worldly pleasure, when all I possess is grief, God be then my treasure. Be my vision in the night, be my hope and refuge, till my face is turned to sight, Lord, my heart will praise you. And oh, my soul, hope in God, my help, my rock, I will praise him. Sing, oh sing, through the raging storm, you're still my God, my salvation. And oh my soul, put your hope in God, my help, my rock, I will praise him. Sing, oh sing, through the raging storm, you're still my God, my salvation.
Yes, Lord, you are still my God. You are still my salvation. Even when we go through the raging storm, Lord, you are my help. You are my rock. And I will praise you. And I will speak to my soul, put my hope in God. Lord, help us to learn this precious truth. especially for our brothers and sisters who are going through storms without end. Help our brothers and sisters to continue to hold on tightly to you, to keep on trusting you until your deliverance comes, Lord. Lord, help us not to be distracted by the voices from outside and the voices within. Help us to speak the truth of God. Hope in God, for I will yet praise his name. Lord, help us as we journey through life. Help us to keep looking to you. Just as a psalmist desire that, Lord, that we want more of you. We want to be in your presence. Help us, Lord, as we commit ourselves afresh to you. Even tonight as we sleep, may your word continue to saturate our mind and tutor our heart to trust in God. As we pray all this together, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. I trust that you've been blessed by the Lord. And I see you all next week, where we will learn more about the standard psalm and find hope in God. Amen. So God bless you. See you all next week. Yes.